prayer and opening song service. Now let's turn our Bibles. Let's go to Luke chapter 17. Luke chapter 17. And as you know, in this section of the Gospel of Luke, we have chapter 17 where our Lord is giving various signs in regard to his second coming. But what we have in verses 31 through 33 is kind of a pause. We could almost make this as part of the fifth sign in regard to it being like the days of Lot, because what we're going to see in verse 32. But it's kind of a pause to the signs that are going to be in the world in the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, where instead he gives a warning and also kind of a command or a mandate to the believers of that generation as to what to do upon his second advent. So that's what we're going to see in these three verses. And so let's read them now as we look at chapter 17 now in verses 31 through 33. But again, go back to verse 28 to kind of summarize the concept and what we're talking about. In verse 28 it says, "It was the same as happened in the days of Lot. They were eating, they were drinking, they were buying, they were selling, they were planting, they were building. But on the day that Lot went out from Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all." In verse 30, "It will be just the same on the day that the Son of Man is revealed." So in the second advent of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, all the unbelievers and wicked and evilness in the world is going to be wiped out at that point in time. Then in verse 31, it says, "On that day, let not the one who is on the housetop and whose goods are in the house go down to take them away. And likewise, let not the one who is in the field turn back. Remember Lot's wife. Whoever seeks to keep his life loses it, and whoever loses his life shall preserve it." And so I'm going to stop there, because then in verse 34 and 35, we have another sign of our Lord's second advent. But here again, it's that reminder that, again, we are not to stop and go back. And again, as the tribulational believers specifically, when they see the coming of the Lord, don't stop and go back and get the stuff of this world and gather together and take that with you. Instead, just run out of the house, and wherever you are, out in the field, if you're working in that sense, just run to where the Lord is leading you at that point in time. So this is a specific message of warning that our Lord is giving as to what not to do at his second coming. And he gives us the object lesson of Lot's wife and what she did when she was warned to escape the city at its destruction. Yet, as you know, she turned back. She looked back. It was turned into the pillar of salt, as it were. But that is what we aren't to do, is to continue to look back at the old life, at the place that God is actually saving us from, wishing and desiring that we can go back to that place or be back in that place once again. So as we see in verse 31, again, just to give you a little comparison of Scripture with Scripture, this is also closely associated with what our Lord spoke in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 24, verses 17 and 18, in Mark as well, which are the parallel verses, and then our Lord will speak to us in Luke's Gospel in chapter 21. Let's turn to Matthew chapter 24 and verses 17 through 18. And look at that, because there is actually a little bit different context that goes along with the Gospel of Matthew, Mark, and Luke 21 in the application of this principle. But as we see it here specifically in Luke chapter 17, it is the principle of the actual second coming of our Lord, his second advent when he comes to planet Earth. But the other applications are more in regard to the tribulational time period well before our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ comes back. So in Matthew chapter 24 and verses 17 through 18, again, in verse 17, let's go back to verse 15. In verse 15 it says, "Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation, which was spoken of through Daniel the prophet, standing in the holy place, let the reader understand. Now, you all know that the abomination of desolation is when the Antichrist, which we've studied over the last couple of months in regard to this topic that we're noting in Luke 17, when the Antichrist goes into the rebuilt and restored temple and establishes himself as the Christ, so wanting to be worshipped as the Christ. Again, we know that he is the false Christ, ergo the Antichrist. Again, that is the abomination of desolation. When he establishes himself as the God, the Christ, the one that the world is to worship, and establishes his image there and wants the people then to sacrifice unto him. That is when, again, that great warning is going to go out in regard to what Jesus Christ then says in the following verses. And he utilizes the same phrase. And so let me read it and then I'll come back to that application. Then in verse 16, it says, "Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let him who is on the housetop not go down to get the things out that are in the house. And let him who is in the field not turn back to get his cloak. But woe to those who are with children and who are nursing babes in those days. But pray that your flight may not be in the winter or on the Sabbath. For then there will be a great tribulation such as has not occurred since the beginning of the world until now, nor ever shall." And again, I'll just get verse 22 and then we'll stop there. "And unless those days had been cut short, no life would have been saved. But for the sake of the elect, those days shall be cut short." So basically what we're talking about here is in the middle part, or towards the middle part of the tribulational time period, which is that 7-year time period, the Antichrist is going to come in, establish himself as the God, the Christ, the Savior, and the God of all gods that ever existed throughout time, and demand to be worshipped. That is the abomination of desolation that Daniel spoke about. And it says to the believers in Judea and in Israel, Jerusalem, during that day, get out of that place. Get out right then and there. And run. And just run off into the wilderness. And that will be the same for all believers throughout the world as well, because at that point in time, there's going to be a Holocaust like the world has never seen. And the Antichrist is going to try to wipe out the Jewish people, even greater than the Holocaust that we saw during World War II. And he's going to try to wipe out all the Christians around the world as well who are refusing to worship him, because now they all recognize that he is not the Christ and he is just a puppet of Satan and his cosmic system. So run and run into the woods and let God care for you and provide for you wherever you are. And so that's the message that God has given to the tribulational saints. So, again, sorry for all you preppers who want to prep and have your store bunker, you know, there up in the woods somewhere, and you're going to run to that place. No, that's not what God says. God says what? Leave everything behind. Leave it all behind and just let it go. Because why? He will provide for you. And if you're going to try to go back and collect all your stuff and have it so that you can survive during this time period, guess what? You're going to get wiped out. You're going to be destroyed during that time period, and it's going to be a great demonstration of the lack of your faith in God and the Lord Jesus Christ, because he says, run, and I will care for you, just as he did with Lot and his family, and said, run, get out of there. I will provide for you. So that's the message that we see in the Gospel of Matthew, Mark, and then Luke chapter 21. But going back to our passage in chapter 17, he utilizes the same phraseology, but for a different application. Because in the application that we have in our passage, this is called the Day of the Lord, which really is speaking about his second advent, when he comes back and plants his feet on planet Earth and ultimately is wiping out evil that is in the world at that point in time. But for whatever reason, he speaks to these believers during that time. And he comes back, and we're going to read in the book of Zechariah in just a minute, Old Testament, where Jesus Christ comes back, plants his feet on planet Earth, separates the land so that the Israelites can escape out of Jerusalem. And again, those who are still alive at that point in time escape out, as then God and Jesus Christ and you and I who are coming back with him wipe out the forces of the world that are attacking Jerusalem at that point in time. And then again, the Antichrist and all the evil and wickedness and unbelievers that are in the world during that time. So he gives the same command to flee and to not turn back, not look back. Don't go get your stuff and collect it and bring it with you because you need those things. But instead, head for, again, we could say head for the hills, as we would call it, but head through the valley that Jesus Christ is going to create, and he will care and provide for them. So let's turn our Bibles to Zechariah. And again, back in the Old Testament, again, one of the minor prophets. Again, as we look in our scriptures, and again, towards the end, it's actually the second to last book of the Old Testament. You got Malachi being last, but then you have Zechariah just before, and Haggai just before that. And in Zechariah chapter 14, pretty much really just verses 1 through 7. And when we see this Old Testament scripture as well, and you can read beyond what I'm going to read to you this morning on your own, it kind of blends everything together. It kind of talks about during the tribulation, at the second coming of our Lord, and then it also speaks and goes right into the millennial reign. So as we look at the book of Zechariah, in chapter 14, in verse 1, it says, "Behold, a day is coming." That's the day of the Lord. "For the Lord, when the spoil taken from you will be divided among you." Again, what's been taken from the Israelites will be given back to them. "For I will gather all the nations against Jerusalem to battle, and the city will be captured. The house is plundered." Now, let me pause there for just a minute. When he says, "I will gather them together," it's actually the Antichrist that is going to be gathering them all together, having them all come again to warfare against the people of Jerusalem, who will be holding out. And again, that last bastion of a salvation for the people of Israel, holding out and fighting against the Antichrist at this point in time. Again, the world forces are going to come up against them. But it will be the Antichrist that's doing that. But remember, Jesus Christ controls history. And he's going to allow, again, the Antichrist to gather them. And in fact, he gathers them in that warfare so that ultimately he will wipe them out. All right, so it says, "The house is plundered, the women ravished, and half the city exiled. But the rest of the people will not be cut off from the city. Then the Lord will go forth and fight against those nations as when he fights on a day of battle. And in that day, his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives, which is in front of Jerusalem on the east. And the Mount of Olives will be split in its middle from east to west by a very large valley, so that half of the mountain will move towards the north and the other half towards the south. And you will flee by the valley of my mountains, for the valley of the mountains will reach to Aziel. Yes, you will flee, just like you fled as before the earthquake in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah. Then the Lord my God will come, and all the holy ones with him." And again, you and I will come back in victory, and all the other believers that are of the church age coming back with him, the bride of Christ, who now will be his wife. In verse 8 it says, "And it will come about, in that day there will be no light, and no luminaries will dwell." The luminaries will dwindle. It says, "For it will be a unique day, which is known to the Lord, neither day nor night, but it will come about that at evening time there will be light." And again, you can compare these other scriptures, as I have for you up on the board, in Isaiah and Joel, and also in Malachi as well. And then in Matthew 24, verse 29 through 31, and the book of Revelation, which talks about that scene. And again, the second advent of our Lord and the things that happened just prior to that time period. And during that time period in Revelation, the lights, again, the sun will be darkened, the moon will be darkened, the stellar universe will be darkened, as it says. And then ultimately our Lord will come back. So these are all great signs and miracles and wonders that are going to occur at the second advent of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But there are two aspects where Jesus Christ says flee. One is when the Antichrist establishes himself in the temple and then ultimately flee at that point in time, because after that he's just going to wreak havoc on the world in a great holocaust of Jewish and Christians during that time. But then those who do are now able to survive at the second advent of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, as we just read in Zechariah, he's going to give them a way of escape as then his forces rained down on the people of planet Earth. Just like the fire and brimstone rained down on Sodom and Gomorrah and the other three cities and totally wiped them out. Again, Jesus Christ and you and I on horseback are going to be coming back, and we are going to be the hailstones and the fire that are coming down, the fire and brimstone that is coming down to wipe them out. And it's going to seem like it's, like fire and brimstone, but ultimately it's going to be you and I and the sword of the Spirit coming back to absolutely wipe them out. But he will give those Israelites a way of escape so they are spared from that. They are freed from that so that those individuals are then able to do what? Walk into the millennial reign and be part of the kingdom, the 1,000-year millennial reign. So again, you can read all those scriptures and see what's going on there, but our Lord is giving a warning. And these two warnings are, first and foremost, not to stop and go back. Don't stop if you're on the housetop. And again, going down, and back in the ancient days, the housetop was a very, important part of their living and of their lifestyle. And many things, as I've given you notes, they would do upon the housetop. And it was also part of the daily work, and some of the daily work would get performed up on the rooftop. So again, if you're up there, don't go down into the house and collect all your things. And the Greek word that we see there, and again, I've given that to you in your notes as well, talk about the utensils, the implements, the things that you would have to perform your everyday life and what they needed back in the day. So again, you don't stop and collect those things before you run thinking that I need this, I need to cook, I need to sew, I need to, mend, I need to, farm. So I need these certain tools and implements and I need to bring them with me. Otherwise, how am I going to survive? God says, don't even bother. I will provide for you. So what he's talking about here is a great act of faith, especially at his second advent. Don't worry about the things of this life. Don't turn back to them and think that you're going to protect your life, save your life, or provide for your life going forward. God is going to do all of that. And if we stop and collect all of our stuff and bring it with us, it's a showing that we have what? A lack of faith in God. That we're not trusting in him and relying upon him. And we're not trusting and relying upon his word. And we aren't being obedient to his word because he says what? Just go and run at that point in time. So again, these are two great warnings that are given to us that ultimately show us that God is going to provide all of their needs. And yes, this is specifically speaking to those tribulational saints at his second advent, but it's a principle of faith that we should be taking away each and every day. And again, trust in God for all your needs. Trust in God to provide you a job to work at. Trust in God to provide you a home and a dwelling for you to live in. Trust in God to provide the food that comes to your table each and every day. And yes, I know and understand we all have to do things and actions and functions, to make that all come together and happen. But remember, faithfully, God is doing those for you. And he's providing them for you each and every day. And we have to worry about this, that, or the other thing, and certainly not get into the mentality of, I've got to provide for myself. I've got to do this. I've got to do that. Where, then you get into the prepper mentality of saving and storing for that great day of survival, just so you know that you can survive. Okay? And what's probably going to happen is God's, like he did with the manna in heaven and the dove or the quail that he gave to the Israelites that they murmured and complained about. He turned it all to what? Maggots as it was in their mouth. He's probably going to do that with all that prep of food that you've stored up, okay? Because it's showing a lack of faith. Again, trust in your God. Trust in him each and every day, and he will care for you. But if we aren't trusting wholeheartedly, again, we will get into that mode of operation of doing what? Trusting in ourselves, making ourselves our own God and relying upon ourselves, and that will erode away at the faith that you have in God. And it will erode away at the faith rest that you have in God as well. Where now it's all about you and providing and caring and doing your thing, rather than trusting in the Lord to care for you and provide for you each and every day. And for that tribulational time period, there are even more verses that I could give you, but that's another topic for another day, that speak to what? God providing for you. Just run to the wilderness and he will care for you. So again, it gives us an understanding of the great demonstration that we ought to be having of faith in God, being obedient to His Word, just as we're going to see in a minute, Lot and his wife, his entire family were mandated, commanded by the angels of God not to turn back. Do not look back. Just keep going forward and don't look back. Because if you do, it's a good sign of what? You're not trusting in God. You're not faithful in God. Then you're more concerned with your past life than you are with your current walk with the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so again, we take the principle away. We aren't to be, you know, faithful in the things of this world to sustain us and protect us. But instead, we are to be faithful in God to provide us all those things, the job that we need, the car we need to drive, the food, the money, all the things that we need to survive in this world. Trust that God will provide those things for you and lead you in the right direction to give you those things, whether it be a job or the food or whatever the case may be. God will provide all of your needs. So we have to ask ourselves, are we trusting in God or are we trusting in ourselves? So God mandates that we take nothing with us, or they take nothing with them at His second coming. And if they do that, it shows a wholehearted, faithful walk that they have with Him that day and each and every day. So as we understand, again, He says stop, to take nothing at all. Just escape. Just go. Just take the path that God has given to you. And sometimes in life, God's going to tell you, pick up and go. Don't even worry about what has been behind. Just pick up and go forward and move forward in the plan of God, as He will care for you and provide for you and all your needs. But ultimately, they're stopping and taking, or if they were to go into the house and get these tools or the implements or the utensils or the things they needed to be sustained in their life, if they stopped and did that, it was just like Lot's wife stopping and looking back at Gomorrah. Or Sodom and Gomorrah, looking back at the cities as she turned back in a longing way for the life that she had there. And again, we don't have any detail about, you know, her life there. We know a lot about Lot and what was going on in Lot's life. We know about Lot's two daughters and that they were engaged ultimately to be married, and there was a wedding that would be coming up. But we don't know anything more about Lot's wife other than this scene. And so we don't know if she was steeped in the immorality of that life as well. But apparently she wasn't fully faithful and didn't have the faith in God as the other three did, as they continued to go forward without looking back and longing and desiring for the old life. And you see, this is another problem that the Israelites also had as they were wandering in the wilderness, and even as they came into the new land as well. They continued to do what? Look back to Egypt. And that's a great phrase that we use inside of theology, of looking back to Egypt. And what is that? Looking back to the old life. Looking back to the old sinful life. Looking back to Satan and his cosmic system. The thing that you've been freed from. The thing that you have been given escape from through your faith in the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And especially for believers and you and I who have now going forward in the plan of God, saying no to the old sin that we used to trip over each and every day. We should be saying no to those things and not looking back and saying, oh, wouldn't that be nice? Wouldn't it be good to go back there again? Wouldn't it be nice to live in that society once again? And, I used to be in the business world, as you know, and had opportunities where I could have made $1 million in my life. Could have made $1 million and have $1 million in my bank account right now, okay? And it is tempting to say, oh, wouldn't that be nice? better? Is that better? Okay. Did we lose much? All right. So, as I said, you know, we don't look back to the old life. We don't lust and desire for the old ways of doing things, especially if, you know, we came from a sinful lifestyle before we were a believer, and the sin that we were steeped in, and the, you know, immorality or whatever form of sin that we were associated with back then that God has now freed us from and saved us from. We shouldn't want to be looking back to that and saying, oh, shouldn't I go back to that old life? Shouldn't I do those things again? Wouldn't that be fun? Wouldn't that be nice? Shouldn't I go back to that thing? No. We ought to look forward to what God has for us. And as I was saying, in Hebrews chapter 11, we have that list of the Old Testament heroes of faith, okay? The Hall of Fame of faithful believers in the Old Testament. And what does it say about them? They were looking forward to the city, the kingdom, that had been promised to them, even though they never saw it in this life. They always had their eyes on the prize, as we would say. They always had their eyes on God and now our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and the great blessings and promises that God has waiting for us in the eternal state. Rather than being all worried about the things of this world, as my wife and I joke, you know, time and time again, and we just say, burnt, okay? Because it's all going to get burnt up. It's all going to get burnt up, okay? You can't take anything with you from this life into the next life. And everything of this world is going to be absolutely destroyed at the end of the millennial reign. He will destroy the heavens and the earth and create a new heavens and a new earth. And we will enjoy that for all of eternity. But if we are stopping and trying to collect our stuff and get our stuff and make sure I've got this and make sure I've got that and take care of our own needs and our own means and modes of operation with our own human resources, assets, and strengths and abilities, then what aren't we doing? We're not trusting in God and relying upon Him. You see, interesting enough, and let's turn to the book of Numbers. Let's go to the book of Numbers, chapter 11. Because here we see the Hebrews time and time again, as they were released and freed from what? Slavery at the hand of the Egyptians. As they were freed from the slavery and now given their new freedom, they were wandering in the wilderness, and God was caring for them and providing for them. He was giving them food each and every day. He was providing the water that they needed. And He was leading them and having them be victorious in battle after battle, and ultimately preparing them to come into the promised land. But in the book of Numbers, chapter 11, we see the Israelites complaining time and time again. And again, not all of them, but a good and vast majority of them. And longing to what? Be back in Egypt. They wanted to go back to the place of slavery. So in Numbers chapter 11, in verse 4, it says, "And the rabble who were among them had greedy desires. And also the sons of Israel wept again and said, Who will give us meat to eat? We remember the fish which we used to eat in Egypt, the cucumbers and the melons and the leeks and the onions and the garlic. But now our appetite is gone. There is nothing at all to look at except this what? Manna." Again, the great bread or food that God gave them, again, and rained down on them each and every morning. "But now our appetite is gone." Verse 7, it says, "Now the manna was like coriander seed, and its appearance like that of delium." All right, so in any case, now flip over to chapter 18. Let's go to, go down to verse 18, verse 18 and 20. In verses 18 it says, "And say to the people, consecrate yourselves tomorrow, and you shall eat meat. For you have wept in the ears of the Lord, saying, Oh, that someone would give us meat to eat. For we were well off in Egypt. Therefore the Lord will give you meat, and you shall eat. You shall eat not one day, nor 2 days, nor 5 days, nor 10 days, nor 20 days. But a whole month, until it comes out of your nostrils and becomes loathsome to you, because you have rejected the Lord who is among you, and have wept before Him, saying, Why did we ever leave Egypt?" Okay? Constantly looking back to Egypt. All right, let's another scene, chapter 14. Let's go there. in verses 1 through 4. It says in verse 14, "Then all the congregation lifted up their voices and cried, and the people wept that night. And all the sons of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole congregation said to them, would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would that we had died in this wilderness. And why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? Our wives and our little ones will become plunder. Would it not be better for us to return to Egypt?" So they said to one another, "Let us appoint a leader and return to Egypt." So again, complain, complain, complain. Remember, they saw all the signs and miracles and wonders and provisions. And they cried out to God for the 380-something years that they were in slavery. "Save us, Lord, save us, Lord. Deliver us, deliver us." Finally, when they were delivered and provided for and saw all the signs, miracles, and wonders of God. Yet when a little bit of heartache would come, they'd start to complain and whine and murmur and get all mamby-pamby about it, as I like to say, and wish they were back in what? Slavery. Back in slavery. Let's go now to chapter 20, because again, just to show you the examples of time and time again. This is the same group of people that we're talking about here. And here, actually, in this section, actually, Moses got into a little bit of trouble. Because why? He had a little bit of short-temperedness here as well when he was representing God before the entire people. He got a little bit angry at the complaining and the whining and the moaning that was going on. Got a little bit angry, took his staff and struck a rock, and water came forward. But God had commanded him just to wave it over the rock, and the water would come forth. But he struck it instead because he was a little bit angry at these people. Can you blame him, kind of thing? No, okay. But yet, to whom as much is given, much is required. And because he was given much, and the representation of God before the people, because of that one act of anger, then Moses wasn't allowed to go into the promised land. Let me share something with you with that. Let me just go off on a little bit with that, because when I went out to Colorado, remember I went out a couple weeks ago to see my son and our new granddaughter, my grandson out there as well. We visited a church out there, and that pastor was speaking on various things. And one of the things he spoke was on about Moses, and it was interesting how Moses was not able to go into the promised land, okay? And most of us think, oh, divine discipline, you know, and that's kind of what it was. Again, God didn't allow him to go to the promised land because he was representing God. He got angry in front of the people rather than having patience and long-suffering. But this pastor also, you know, brought up the concept of, boy, wasn't that a blessing to Moses. Because what had to happen to the people of Israel to get into the promised land? They had to go get everybody else out of there, like Jericho and all the other fortified cities. And Moses, after all that he went through and wandering in the wilderness for 40 years, and now being at the age of 120 years old, guess what? He was spared what? To lead them all in the warfare that was necessary to capture the promised land. And think about that. That God actually spared him of all of that heartache and warfare and all the other difficulty of coming into the new land. And I said, you know what? Never really thought about it that way before. And what a fantastic blessing that was. Even though, in a sense, it's a discipline that he wasn't able to go into the promised land, guess what? God brought him up on a high rock, and he was able to look at and see the promised land. But even more importantly is that promised land doesn't hold a candle to the promise of the kingdom that God has for each and every one of us. And he actually spared Moses all of the heartache and difficulty of going into warfare as they entered into the promised land. So, again, I thought that was a very astute and wise point that was brought up in that sense. So, now let's go back to Numbers chapter 20 in verses 2 through 5 specifically. But in verse 1 it says, "Then the sons of Israel, the whole congregation, came to the wilderness of Sin, and in the first month, and the people stayed at Kadesh. Now Miriam died there and was buried there. And there was no water for the congregation. And they assembled themselves against Moses and Aaron. The people thus contended with Moses and spoke, saying, if only we had perished when our brothers perished before the Lord. Why then have you brought the Lord's assembly into this wilderness for us and our beasts to die here? And again, this is the third time we're seeing this, and now we're seeing how the Lord had provided, had provided, had provided, had provided, and still they don't think he's going to provide. You brought us out here to die. Then in verse 5 it says, and why have you made us come up from Egypt to bring us to this wretched place? Is it not a place of grain or figs or vines or pomegranates? Nor is there water to drink. All right, then you can read the rest of the story on your own. Again, how Moses responds a little bit negatively here, a little bit of anger here, outside the will and plan of God. But the fact of the matter is they complain time and time again, even though God had provided for them time and time again. And so think about your life, how God has provided for you time and time again. Again, the first time with your salvation, saving you from sin and evil and the wickedness of the world and the eternal lake of fire that's a result of unbelief in Jesus Christ. God has spared you and saved you from that. And then in your life, all the different things that God has given to you over time, taking you out of one place, put you into another, removed you from this place, and sent you in another. How many times has God led you in your life and provided for you? And yet you don't think he's going to do it tomorrow or the next day or the next day? Absolutely, he's going to. The Israelites, again, they never learned, the ones wandering in the wilderness. That's why they all perished before they were able to go into the promised land, because all of them had negative mental attitude and were untrusting and unfaithful to God. And so again, as we have the story of Lot, which happened many hundreds of years after the fact of them coming out, Egypt and then into the promised land. We see that many years later. And in that event, we see God sparing Lot and his family in a fantastic way, but reminding them of one thing: don't look back. Don't long for the old days. Don't long for the sinful days. Don't long for the things of this world even. And again, I'm sure Sodom and Gomorrah in those five cities had many riches and wealth, and they were probably beautiful cities. And there was a lot of good society there from a humanistic standpoint, with a lot of beauty and wealth. But we also understand of the evil and corruption that was in that place. And yet Lot's wife longed to go back to that place. She longed for the things that God had given her escape from, rather than saying, God's given me escape, now let me go forward in the plan of God. And I'm going to trust. And guess what? I ain't going to look back. I'm not going to think twice about that thing. I'm not thinking twice about that sin I used to enter into all the time. I'm not thinking twice about the worldliness that I could have had or should have had or once did have. I'm not going to think twice about that. Why? Because God's got a better plan for me. And God's got greater things for me. So let me go forward inside of God's plan and not even give a second thought about what lies behind. And that's why Paul always said, forget what lies behind and reach forward to what lies ahead. These individuals rejected God, rejected his word as was being delivered to them by Moses. They wanted to go back to the way things used to be. And even though they were complaining in the way things used to be, and they wanted escape from the way that things used to be, why would they want to go back? Why would you want to go back to the thing that caused you problems and difficulties and heartache? Why would you want to go back to that sin and that sinful lifestyle? Why would you want to go back to the thing that enslaved you, called sin and Satan's cosmic system? You see, those who are steeped in the world, and certainly the world of sin, are slaves in the mentality of their soul to Satan and his cosmic system. The Israelites were slaves literally to the Egyptians, right? God freed them from that slavery, but yet what? They wanted to go back. I want to go back and be a slave again, because at least I'd have a piece of meat, okay? Hallelujah, piece of meat, okay? Are you kidding me? For a piece of meat. So again, let's not have that slave mentality of wanting to go back to the things that enslaved us of the world and Satan's cosmic system and sin. And the looking back to the old life, the worldly life, the insignificant things compared to the life that God has for you. And again, with the peace and the joy and the happiness and the great impact that you can have in this life, bringing salvation not only to yourselves but to the other people around you, preaching and teaching the truth of the Word of God, filling up heaven with souls rather than allowing them to go to the eternal, and again, eternal lake of fire. What a better life God has given you. What a more productive life God has given to you than anything that this world can offer you. And how blessed are we to be part of that life. And so why do we look back? Again, forget the things that lie behind and reach forward to what lies ahead. And when they had brought in Genesis chapter 19, verse 17, it says, this is the angels warning Lot and his family. It says, when they had brought them outside, one said, "Escape for your life. Do not look behind you, and do not stay anywhere in the valley. Escape to the mountains, or you will be swept away." And so that's the point. And then, as we come back on Tuesday, as we're now going to get into our communion supper, again, we're going to come back and just see that example, a little bit more detail of Lot's wife, how she clung to the things of this world and ultimately lost her life. She was turned into the pillar of salt by God because she was disobedient and she had the longing for sin and Satan's cosmic system. And as a result, she looked back. She looked back at this life. And therefore, God brought that discipline into her life and didn't allow her to continue on in life, as it were. So we'll talk more about that when we come back on Tuesday, but I wanted to get us into the communion supper at this time. So let's just bow our heads and pray. Father, we thank you for this time. We praise you, we worship you, we glorify you. And we thank you, Father, for all that you have given to us and done for us and provided for us. And we ask that you now continue to bless us as we celebrate you and your Son, Jesus Christ, in the glory and praise and honor of him as we celebrate the cup and the bread. So, Father, we thank you for this time. In Christ's precious name, amen. All right, so Gary and Junior, would you want to come forward and pass out the communion elements? And just to point your attention to the board, you can see this spire out there in the wilderness out there in Israel and whatnot. And when you look at it, actually there's another picture like this too, where at the bottom you can really see almost like this big face on it, okay? But this is a pillar of stone that's out there in the desert that many people think, oh, that's Lot's wife, okay? And so that's what it would look like, potentially, as she was turned into a pillar of salt. So you can almost see it, too, like the head at the top and the body and the flowing dress and all that stuff. So sometimes they point to this as Lot's wife still there. But in any case, we're going to celebrate communion right now. We're going to celebrate our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So let's just pray for this time. And Father, we come before you humbly in praise and worship of what your Son Jesus Christ has done for us on the cross. We thank you for our personal salvation and all that has been done so that we can live with you for eternity in your glory. So Father, we praise you and glorify you this time in Christ's name. Amen.
If you and cradled in his arms, I was carried to the table, seated where I don't belong, carried to the table, swept away by his love. And I don't see my brokenness anymore. When I'm seated at the table of the Lord, I'm carried to the table, the table of the Lord. Thoughts of fear, wondering why he called my name. Am I good enough to share this cup. This world has left me lame. Even in my weakness, the Savior called my name. In His holy presence, I'm healed and unashamed.
Passing out those elements and continuing on in the theme of, again, not looking back, and what we're going to see as we continue to note and understand these principles. And in Matthew chapter 10, verse 35, it says, "He who has found his life shall lose it, and he who has lost his life for my sake shall find it." And this is the command and the mandate that our Lord gave to his disciples and also gives to you and I in our day and age as well. Again, if we are all about this life, this world, and trying to maintain and hold on to these things and doing that, with the absolute exclusion to a relationship with God, not thinking about His provision and providing those things for us, but trying to gain a life of worldliness and sin, then we're going to lose this life that we have. And again, we could lose our physical life as a result, but also the spiritual life that we otherwise could have had. But then it says, "And he who has lost his life for my sake shall find it." And when we think about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, remember, He was God who came down to earth and took on the form of man. He gave up His heavenly life, as it were, came down and took on this measly life of our human body and the things that we operate and function in. And again, as I showed you that video last week of the stellar universe and how, you know, minute we actually are. I think I said on Thursday night, we are smaller compared to our universe than one atom is within our physical body. Again, just think about that, okay? And Jesus Christ yet loved us so much that He left all of that behind, as it were, and came down and took on humanity and became like us. And even that life He didn't establish to be set up on a throne with a kingdom and be glorified, but ultimately He even gave that life go to the cross and pay the penalty for our sins. And He who had no sin took on the sins of the entire world, became sin, so that we could have everlasting life. And again, Jesus Christ gave His life, He lost His life, but then what happened? He was raised on the third day. And on the third day, raised to eternal glory, and then ascended into heaven, and is now seated at the right hand of God the Father. And in His humanity, He is now there in a place of glory, and one day His kingdom will come to earth. But because He lost His life, gave His life, ultimately He found His life and the glory that God had for Him. And that is the same concept that you and I need to live in each and every day. As it also says, somewhat in a parallel verse in Mark chapter 8, verse 35, "For whoever wishes to save his life shall lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's," I love that, "and the gospel's, shall save it." And then in John chapter 12, verse 25, "He who loves his life loses it, and he who hates his life in this world shall keep it to eternal life." And remember, that hate isn't that kind of anger and bitterness and "I hate this, I hate that," and blah, 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 complain and murmur, okay? This is loving less, so not loving it as much as you love your life with the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. "Whoever hates his life in this world shall keep it to eternal life." And if we are living for ourselves, which means we come off the rooftop and collect our stuff before we go out, if we're in the field, I gotta go back home and get my stuff before I can escape, that's loving your life. And if you do that, you're going to lose that life. But if you are obedient to the Word of God and have faith in God, you're going to get from that rooftop. You're going to jump off that rooftop right down to the street. You don't care what's in the house, and you're going to go. You're going to be in the field. You're just going to drop everything, and you're going to go and follow the lead of your Lord. And that's those who hate this life. They just follow the lead of the Lord. And wherever He goes, wherever He takes, and you trust all the way that He is going to provide for you. And as we celebrate our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ through the bread and the wine, remember, Jesus Christ took on that human life, and He gave that human life. He gave His physical life so that ultimately we could have everlasting life. First, he started with his spiritual life, where he paid the penalty for our sins upon the cross. Again, taking on every one of our sins and being judged for them, he died spiritually so that we would not have to. And there he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Because Jesus Christ has given his life on our behalf, first his spiritual life and demonstrated through his physical life, you and I now have eternal life. So we celebrate him and give thanks to him by eating the bread in remembrance. And Jesus Christ didn't just stop at his physical life, but again, wanted to emphasize the spiritual life that he gave on our behalf. Yes, he took on humanity, left his deified powers. He didn't leave them behind, but did not use them. He was still God controlling the heavens and the earth, but yet he took on humanity and didn't use his deified powers to solve his problems and to establish a kingdom. Instead, he gave his life on our behalf. And in that life, again, the most important aspect of that was the spiritual death, where he took on the sins of the entire world as represented by the shedding of blood. And so when we drink this cup, we recognize the spiritual death that Jesus suffered on our behalf for the forgiveness of our sins. So let us drink the cup. As Paul recounted, as often as you eat the bread and drink the cup, you proclaim Christ until he returns. And so we look forward to that day of his coming. And for those who are tribulational believers and see his coming, what they also have to do is what? Flee to the mountains when he comes, just as he has said. So again, Jesus Christ gave his life, but yet found a new life where he is in resurrected form, will come back in that second advent and bring his kingdom down to planet Earth. So let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, we thank you and praise you and your son Jesus Christ and give thanks to him for all that he has done for our salvation, the work upon the cross 2,000 years ago, and also looking forward to the near future where your kingdom will come and ultimately be restored here on planet Earth. So Father, we thank you for your son Jesus Christ and our own personal salvation, and we glorify you as we glorify him. Father, we thank you for this time in Christ's name. Amen. All right, thank you very much. If you want to pass your cups to the aisle, Steve will collect them. All right, now is our time to partake of an offering. So we'll take an offering right now. And I'll pray, and Barry's on vacay this weekend, so I'll say the prayer for our offering. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time of giving. We give back to you all the first fruits of all that you've given to us, Father, and we can't thank you enough for what you have provided and what we know you will continue to provide. And so we offer these things up to you in thanksgiving because they are yours, and therefore we return them to you in thanks. So, Father, we thank you for this offering in Christ's name. Amen. The headlights and the